Welcome you all to yet another interesting session on the theme US-India Strategic Partnership. To talk on the subject, we have with us the most experienced US diplomat, Mr. Richard Verma. He was formerly the US Ambassador to India and currently the Executive Vice President, Global Public Policy and Regulatory Affairs at MasterCard. He will engage in a fireside chat with President Fiquet, Dr. Sangeeta Reddy. I now request her to kindly open the session and take the conversations forward. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. What a pleasure it is to be in conversation with Mr. Richard R. Verma, Executive Vice President, Global Public Policy and Regulatory Affairs, MasterCard. Mr. Verma joined MasterCard from capital advisory firm, the Asia Group, where he served as a vice chair and partner. He was also the U.S. Ambassador to India from 2014 to 2017, three wonderful years, where he led one of the largest U.S. diplomatic missions and championed historic progress in bilateral cooperation on defense, trade, and clean energy. It is my privilege to welcome you, Ambassador Verma. Thank you for agreeing to be with us at the FICCI Convention in conversation today.
Yeah, it's great to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me. I've done a lot of great work with FICCI over the years, and terrific organization, wonderful people. So thank you for having me.
So we're very happy you're here. As you know, the India-US bilateral relations have developed into a global strategic partnership based on shared democratic values and increasing convergence of interests on bilateral, regional, and global issues. And there's always been this strong bipartisan support in the United States and in India for the relationship, reflecting its strength and wide acceptance and dynamism, and probably also reflecting the fact that there are so many Indians in America. In the last two decades, our relationship has been on an upward trajectory. U.S. goods and services trade with India amounted to over $150 billion, with the potential to grow even more. The cumulative FDI inflows from the U.S. during April 2000 to June 2019 amounted to $27.01 billion. And all major U.S. Fortune 500 companies are among the 2,000 U.S. companies that have invested in India. They see this huge market, this consonance of ideology and thought process. And at the same time, Indian companies, approximately 200, have invested more than $22 billion in the U.S. economy, and they have created more than 125,000 jobs in the U.S. One of the important pillars of the India-U.S. strategic partnership is energy. But the bilateral energy trade is set to cross $10 billion, and the United States is becoming an increasingly important partner in India's energy security, but also there's a consonance of ideology with the Solar Alliance. India is not only buying, but also investing in energy in the United States. Another important pillar for our defense is the defense partnership, which is stronger than ever before. India was designated as a major defense partner of the United States in 2016, and our defense trade has crossed $21 billion. Agreements such as the LIMOA, the COMCASA, have enabled us to use a common platform by our forces and also the exchange of high-end technology. The Indian policy of enabling greater investment into FDI and a greater share of defense companies has also been very significant in this sector. And the 2+2 dialogue between our defense and foreign ministers has been successful in steering our defense partnership. And on the healthcare front, our knowledge partnership with the U.S. for developing the COVID-19 vaccine is indispensable. Other areas we are closely working on are climate change, clean and renewable energy, and India has taken leadership in the world through initiatives such as the International Solar Alliance and the Coalition of Disaster Resilient Infrastructure. I must not continue to say more when our expert is actually with us. So it is indeed a pleasure, on the back of the important and true bridge between India and US relationships, the strong and vibrant India-American community, numbering over 4 million. It is a great pleasure for me to talk about what we can do and to ask for your views, whether it's in cutting-edge and emergent technologies, in AI and data analytics, and an integral part of the innovation ecosystem are the Indian diaspora, which truly, I think together, we not only help to make each other's economy competitive and vibrant, but also can help the world. So in this backdrop, in the next 15 to 20 minutes, I would be very keen to ask you and get your candid views on some of the questions which arise out of the Indian economic and social landscape. So thank you, Ambassador Varma, starting with question number one. So this is a fun one. The Indian democracy is about four times the size of the American democracy with very different and complex systems. We're not binary here. For centuries, both democracies have thrived with peaceful transfer of power from one administration to another. Since all Indians were tracking the US electoral results with very keen interest, it was intriguing to see that while India can declare results of election in a couple of days, in the US, it was like a roller coaster ride, stretching the results over a week. What's your takeaway from that?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think we're actually still living through it today. I think there are 17 states that are challenging the election results before the Supreme Court. I don't think that's likely to garner much support. So what's interesting, look, we are in a divided country, no question about it. And some of the results were exceptionally close. Under some of the states, if you came within 1% of the margin, there was an automatic recount. And, you know, elections in our country, even the federal elections, are very much run and administered by states and localities. So you have very, you know, different procedures in all of the 50 states. So that makes it a little challenging, but that's just the way our system is. You know, but I think our system has also proved to be fairly resilient through a lot of challenges. A lot are just political in nature. They don't, as I said, this recent one doesn't appear to have much credence to it. And so there, you know, one of our great hallmarks is a peaceful transition. I think we will have that. We are a bit behind, but, you know, I think I choose to be a little bit hopeful during some very difficult times. These are difficult times in the United States and globally with the pandemic, with our economic situation. But I look also at the promise of a vaccine coming out. I look at the transition. I look at the Biden administration about who's coming in. And I'm hopeful that we can turn the corner. And frankly, I'm excited about where U.S.-India relations can go, because I think the kinds of people that he's appointed to top jobs recognize the critical importance of this relationship. And finally, I just say, yes, our democracy is still a work in progress. And to the extent we can learn from other countries about how to run a better election, we should certainly do that.
Your democracy is a work in progress. But I think that's the most positive note, because people must continue to continuously improve.
That's right.
Moving on, and I completely echo, you know, your sentiment. We look forward to a great relationship with President Biden. On a more serious note, it's a popular belief that there's a great deal of support for India in Washington, D.C. And given this bipartisan support, it doesn't matter who comes to power in D.C. How true is that? And what is the source of this support? Going forward, what do you think will be some of the positive aspects, or maybe even some of the negative aspects for India to develop or to mitigate a strategy while dealing with the new administration and continuing to have a strong U.S.-India relationship?
Yeah, I think you said it exactly right. I think there is strong bipartisan support in Washington for the U.S.-India relationship. I think it's gotten to the point where it's actually nonpartisan. When I look at the largest single grouping in the House of Representatives, the largest caucus in the House is the U.S.-India caucus in grouping together members of all political persuasions. The Senate Democratic Caucus equally supportive. So that comes from a lot of different things. That comes from our Indian American diaspora, which is incredibly strong and powerful. That comes from the fact that we are naturally aligned. Prime Minister Modi and other prime ministers in India have talked about us as natural allies. President Obama used to call this the defining partnership of the 21st century. And when I was working in the Senate, and then Senator Biden was the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee in 2006, he actually looked ahead to this year, and in a speech in the Senate, he said, if in 2020, the U.S. and India are the closest friends and partners, the world will be a safer place. So we've had this sense that this is our partnership of this century. Now, we have a lot of work to do to live up to those high aspirations, and we can certainly talk about those areas. But I think this is a very good time for U.S.-India relations. You have a terrific ambassador and Ambassador Sandhu here in Washington, who's representing the government quite well. And so, again, I think this can be a very, very good chapter building on the last, as you said, 20 years. I think it sometimes people forget our progress on U.S.-India ties is only about two decades old. Before that, we were kind of stuck for many, many years. So 20 years is not a very long time. We have a lot of ground to make up for, but we've certainly made good progress.
So on that truly positive note, I think all of us believe that good economics makes for good politics as well. And there has been a focus on the strategic and the defense ties in the context of the Indo-Pacific. And otherwise, over the past few years, given the fact that Indo-US relationship is based on a broader complementarity between the two democracies, do you see that the Biden era will repair some of the damage that was done in the trade and investment matrix and the economic front that happened over the last few years, and while maintaining the synergy of the geostrategic cooperation under the Indo-Pacific and other constructs?
Yes. So I think the U.S.-India relationship has to be about more than the defense partnership. The defense partnership is exceptionally important, and we have important shared interests for a free and open Indo-Pacific. This is a concept that, again, is about 20 years old. It didn't start 3 years ago or 4 years ago. During the Obama administration, as you mentioned, we launched the Joint Strategic Vision for the Indo-Pacific. We designated India a major defense partner, and our defense sales, really surged. Our defense exercises surged. So I'm very confident about where the defense relationship is. The one thing we have to do, though, is connect the strategic and the economic. The economic can't be isolated. It can't be on a lesser track or of lesser importance. And we were able to do that. We had the strategic and economic dialogue. I hope that's something the Biden administration brings back, because there are some challenges on the economic side, and they're on both sides. Look, there's rising nationalism around the world, rising protectionism around the world. And so we need to really fully develop our trade and economic relationship. As you mentioned, it's about $150-160 billion in two-way trade, but we can do far better than that. Our U.S.-China trade numbers are about over 700 billion. So we can do much more in the U.S.-India trade relationship. There are some things that are missing, however. We don't have the structures in place. There's no bilateral investment treaty. There's no free trade agreement. There's no structure for a big, complicated commercial relationship. So I think this is an area where we can actually do a lot of work. There's significant interest on both sides, and we're going to have to make the case to our respective populations that increased trade and investment between U.S. companies and Indian companies is good for both countries. I can make that case quite strongly, and we've seen it play out in both nations. As you said, Indian companies are investing billions of dollars in the United States, and it's the same with American companies in India. But there are some issues we have to work through, and I'm not sure we have the right dialogues in place, the right structures, the right legal frameworks. There's still a lot of challenges, and we shouldn't make it that hard for businesses on both sides.
Absolutely, Ambassador Verma, I think you hit the nail right on the head. There was a lot of hope that India and US will sign a trade deal before the recently concluded elections, but that did not happen. So what is your view? You're right that we need it, but what's your view on a trade deal or an FTA between these two countries? Can it be a reality? Which issues are standing in the way of us concluding something? How would you take this forward?
Yeah, look, I think a lot of good work was done on what we're calling the mini trade deal, because it is a small group of issues, but important issues. So why not get that one done, build some confidence, and move on to bigger issues? I think we're still a ways off from a free trade agreement, but it's something we can aspire to. But in the meantime, we can do the mini trade deal. We can perhaps do a bilateral investment treaty, which we haven't done with India. We should do that. We can resolve some of our differences on immigration and skilled labor, for example. We can resolve some of our differences on market access, on cross-border flows of data, on technology transfer. Look, we are natural partners. And so, and our businesses and our entrepreneurs and our universities and our people are naturally inclined to work with each other. So let's get the two governments in sync, and move forward with where our people want to go.
You're absolutely right. The people, the ideology, even the lifestyles, so much commonality, and of course the education, and taking this further, the business, research, our ability to work together to build new frontiers of common abundance for everybody. I think there is so much opportunity, and I like your thoughts of, you know, let's take baby steps, but continuous steps towards growing cooperation and collaboration. We at FICCI will continue to propound this. I think we've always been very positive about an FTA with the USA and methodologies to enhance trade. So we will continue to propound this. Thank you for that thought. Moving on, I think there's been a focus on strategic and defense ties in the context of Indo-Pacific and otherwise over the past few years. Given the fact that Indo-US relationship is based on a broader complementarity between the two democracies, do you see the Biden era maintaining this momentum of geostrategic cooperation under the Indo-Pacific construct, which also has interest of like-minded nations like Japan, Australia, Indonesia? Where do you see that evolving?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, I've had the privilege and honor of working with President-elect Biden for 20 years, starting in the Senate, then when he was vice president. And so I know his record very clearly, and I know his record on India very clearly. I mentioned the speech he gave in the Senate, but that was also during the civil nuclear cooperation agreement that the Congress had to pass. And if you talk to the Bush administration officials of that era, they would say that that agreement would not have been possible without then Senator Biden's leadership. You know, I've seen him in India. I've seen him working on these issues for many years. And I know that Secretary of State Blinken and National Security Advisor Sullivan, when the secretary is confirmed and in those roles, again, these are known people, and obviously the vice president elect with her ties to India. We're so
proud. I was
proud
waiting
of,
for you to say that. Thank
yeah,
you.
Well,
I was waiting
well, look,
for you to say that.
Okay. We're so proud of what she's accomplished. So I think you'll have a great team to work on U.S.-India ties. I think they have significant experience. They are clear-eyed about the threats and opportunities in the Indo-Pacific. They are aware of the criticality of the relationship. And there are key areas, right? You mentioned defense, and that's an area that we can build on for sure. I would flag for people this designation of India as a major defense partner. No other country in the world has been designated a major defense partner. So let's work on this. Let's build it out. Let's do what was called for and treat India as if it was an ally for the purposes of technology transfer. And that means working together to build the best equipment and have the best capabilities of any militaries in the world. Secondly, I think energy is a huge area of future cooperation. I look at the commitment that the Biden administration is going to make to renewables and rejoining the Paris Climate Agreement. And when I look at India's commitment on the renewable side, the United States can be a huge partner on renewable energy with India. On the healthcare front, an area that you know well, obviously, I think the U.S. and India can be critically important partners, especially now in vaccine development, in vaccine deployment, in healthcare, in pharmaceutical development, medical devices. This is an area where I think we can do a lot of really good work and on global health security more broadly. And then obviously on trade and investment more broadly, we talked about the things that need to happen. So I'm looking at defense, I'm looking at energy, I'm looking at trade, obviously high tech and innovation, natural partners here in a lot of different areas.
So totally, completely agree with you on all the areas. They're very much what we had flagged in the very beginning. But let's move to the one which I think really strengthens so much of our relationship, Indian information technology and services. Mm-hmm. So this sector has been contributing to the competitiveness of the U.S. economy. America's largest tech companies and financial service organizations, in fact, even like MasterCard that you know well, are being led by Indian Americans like yourself. We see U.S. concerns about market access, e-commerce policy, data localization requirements, while India has concerns about Section 232 tariffs, H-1B visa policies, and totalization agreements. Will these issues impact the interests of the Indian American community in the new U.S. administration? How do you see these panning out?
Look, I think these are all issues that we should talk about and have a regular, not only dialogue, but a pathway to some solution on these issues. And I think, look, on the Indian side, they've been raising Social Security totalization, the limitation on skilled workers for many years. And I think it's time to solve these issues. I don't think we should push them off. And just like I think it's time to solve the concerns on the U.S. side about market access, about intellectual property protection, about regulatory certainty, about cross-border data flows, level playing field. There's a lot we have to solve. On the immigration issue, that's an issue that's personal to me. As I think most of you know, my parents came to the United States in the early 60s, and they started here with next to nothing, and they were able to work their way up. And the fact that their kid could go back and serve as the ambassador from the United States 50 years later is a great, American story, a great immigrant story. And I regret the kind of sense of beating up on immigrants and the anti-immigrant kind of sentiment of the last 3 or 4 years. We've got to remember our roots. We've got to remember what America is about, and that's bringing the best and the brightest here. And I think we do need a broad dialogue and a very comprehensive solution on immigration, where we recall how important India is to this story. I'd say the same thing on the higher education front. I'd love to see more Indian students studying in the United States and more U.S. students studying in India. And we haven't done as much as we can on the higher education front. And so look, between immigration and higher education, we can do a lot right there to give our two countries and to give our two economic systems the confidence that we are connected. Because ultimately, it is our people, it is our values, it is our ideas that bind us together.
So truly, Ambassador Verma, nobody could have said that better than you. You are indeed an ambassador on both sides. I've really enjoyed this conversation, and it bodes so well for the future. I often say I had my early childhood in the U.S. We grew up swearing allegiance to the Stars and Stripes. So I love it when India and America are working together and are in the same step. Being a healthcare person myself, the really last question. I think you spoke about the vaccine collaboration. You spoke about various areas that we can work together in healthcare. Where do you see, can we work together on research? Not just on the curing aspect of this, but on the prediction and the prevention. Where do you see these paths? Maybe early warning signals and systems for pandemic. At no point in time in history has healthcare been so center stage. So do you have any additional thoughts on that? And then we'll call it a wrap.
Absolutely. I think joint research, joint development on innovative drugs and therapies is critical. I think, look, we want to be a part of the Indian healthcare story, the incredible kind of growth in the health delivery of healthcare services in India is so important. But as we talked about, and as President Obama and Prime Minister Modi used to remind us in their 10 or 11 meetings that they had, it's not what just the U.S. and India can do for each other. It's what we can do for the world. It's what we can do together for the world. And so there's a lot riding on our full-scale partnership. So we can have two different kinds of relationships going forward over the next 10 years. We can have a transactional relationship where we buy and sell things from each other, and that will be fine. Or we can have a full-scale partnership where we actually realize the promise of being the natural allies that the Prime Minister talked about. I think we have overcome those hesitations of history that Prime Minister Modi talks about, but we now have to seize upon the talent and good work and enthusiasm there is for this relationship. And that means a full-scale relationship. That means working on health, on science, on space, on climate change, on defense, on clean energy, on education, on development, agriculture. I think we should explore all of those areas, because that's the kind of relationship I think our people expect us to have. And so we can do that. And it'll require Ficky and all of us who believe in this partnership to really push our political leaders and business leaders to move in this direction. As the foreign minister says, it will require strategic choices on the Indian side and on the U.S. side as well. And I think it's time to make those choices so that we can really live up to the promise.
Absolutely, Ambassador Verma. Thank you so much. I think that I will be happy with the biggest takeaway, and that is that India and America working well together is not just good for both our countries, not just good for both our people, but it's good for the world. The common ideology we share is powerful and is important. We have a very good friend of yours, Uday Shankar, who is our incoming president. And I know that as part of FICCI, he will continue the relationship. He's very linked and very connected with the US ecosystem as well. So FICCI will be very much at the forefront of working to forge a stronger partnership and a stronger relationship. Thank you very much, Ambassador Verma. Namaste. I'm going to hand over to our Secretary General, Mr. Dilip Chinoy, to say a formal vote of thanks. And let me say that it was great speaking to you virtually, and we look forward to meeting you in person. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Look forward to seeing you in person, and I look forward to working with your new chairman, who I know quite well and is a terrific person and a leader in so many ways.
Thank you. Very thank good. You, Ambassador Verma. It was always a delight to meet with you and to
be and listen to your views. I think this evening you set a new stage for the future US-India relations by saying it is nonpartisan support, and also referring to the largest caucus in the US. Thank you very much for, you know, on the economic front, putting up two or three things that we could do. And in top of your list was the bilateral investment treaty, and try and conclude the mini trade deal before we go forward. Thank you for focusing on the different areas. You always come across with a fresh set of views and a variety of different ways to interact, always positive, always proactive. It was indeed a pleasure to have you with us this evening. I know it is early morning for you in the US. We look forward to taking this dialogue further. And as you said, we need a full-scale relationship across multiple sectors, and that we can work together to even solve global problems. So thank you, Ambassador Verma, for being with us today. And with that, we just conclude this session on India-US Strategic Partnership. Thank you very much,
and
a good evening.
Thank you very much. Thank you.